to the pop-up exhibition series of the Magnes. Every week we put a speaker in context with objects from the collection. The speaker will be here, and the objects are on display just next to us. And we bring out objects to reflect the varieties of interests and directions of research. For the last 3.5 years here at the Magnes, we've been working with a great project of the University of California, Berkeley, called, with a sort of ugly acronym, the URAP, the Undergraduate Research Apprentice Program of the university. Undergraduates can elect to devote some of their time, their not so free time, to do research with us, and they work in collections, exhibitions, and they often also present in this series. And this is the case today, and Lauren Cooper is about to graduate from UC Berkeley for Comparative Literature. She's worked with us, well, she will tell more about it. She's worked with us for several years and has collaborated on researching collection items that range from contemporary Israeli dolls to co-authoring, co-curating an exhibition that's on display this semester at the Magnes on posters from Yiddish and other Jewish theaters from all over the world. And she was also very instrumental in the making of Mendelssohn, Mendelssohn to Mendelssohn, the exhibition that is sort of a coronation of the work that we've been doing around the important painting in the Magnes collection, and it's on display this academic year. So Lauren is here today to present about her research in the Magnes collection and what the fruits of that research has been. So please join me in welcoming Lauren Cooper.
Bob Dylan albums and a backpack full of books, thinking vaguely of the 1960s and a possible English major. But about a month into my first English class and a few pages into The Sound of the Fury, I realized that an indecipherable Faulkner presented without historical context was not what I wanted to spend 4 years studying. At first, this was frightening, but without the immediate pressure of fulfilling prerequisites for a major, the rest of my first year became an opportunity to try a bit of everything. I signed up for classes in different departments, anthropology, Spanish, American studies, and they gave me incredible opportunities to explore diverse perspectives while gaining a deeper understanding of the way humans think and express themselves. And I realized during this time that in addition to learning about other cultures, I wanted to learn more about my own Jewish culture, something that was defined for me at that point by lighting Hanukkah candles in December and the stories of my great-grandfather, the Talmudic scholar turned junk peddler, whose past in the old country was all but forgotten. He's here on the left with my grandfather. Taking a series of Jewish history courses, I soon acquired both a history minor and a historical interest in recreating and resurrecting lost history. I started by looking into my family's own history, but this proved pretty difficult due to name changes and the like. I was able to dig up some ship's manifests from the Ellis Island archives, and that gave me the moniker in my family of family historian. But it wasn't until 2 years ago that I really had the chance to see what this type of investigative work could do. Having enjoyed the research element of my history classes and this trek into my own family's history, I started looking for research positions the undergraduate research apprenticeship program here at UC Berkeley. Few positions seem to offer independence, and a few seem like they might grow a bit tedious. And then I learned about the Magnes, a research center and museum which offer both hands-on experience with archival materials and opportunities to contribute to future exhibitions. The work seemed ever-changing, and I doubted that it would become dull. I quickly signed on as a research assistant, and now, 2 years later, clear that this is one of the best decisions I made at Berkeley. Work at the Magnes started fast. My first day on the job, I was given 7 Israeli dolls and the name of a workshop that produced them, and I was asked to write catalog descriptions for them. The lack of information was daunting. With a little cultural knowledge of Israel and no experience working with dolls or similar objects, I didn't quite know where to start. So undergraduate, faced with the great unknown would do, I consulted Google. And I realized that the internet does not hold the key to everything. It did, however, give me some leads, a date here and the name of a catalog here. I quickly became a detective, piecing together fragments of information so I could not only describe the dolls, but also situate them and recreate their role in the society that produced them. This type of reconstructive object research is exciting in itself, but a further benefit to working at a museum, and this museum in particular, positioned as it is both in the Bay Area community and the UC Berkeley academic community, is that the research is not confined to the archives. It's presented to the public. Having become a bit of the house expert on the Israeli dolls, I was asked to contribute to an exhibition, Living by the Book, which is up now, that would include them. I selected several dolls, wrote labels, and created digital companions to the exhibition using social media platforms. When the exhibition opened, I had not only reconstructed histories that were nearly lost, but I was also proud to have had a hand in presenting them, both physically and digitally, to a public that can appreciate them as much as I did. My experience working with the great unknown of the dolls proved to be just a taste of what was to come during my time at the Magnes. At the beginning of each semester, it seems, I was confronted with some ideas that I knew nothing about, and each time, I jumped into my new project feet first. First, I trained myself to use social media platforms like Flickr and Findtree to circulate research to a wider audience. Here's a page from the Magnes Findtree account in which I digitally mapped objects from the museum catalog, The Jewish World. Each object can be placed at a precise location, and users can then search that location, be it a street address or a neighborhood, to view objects placed by other users. In this way, a partial picture might be reconstituted with the help of photos from researchers and interested family historians around the world. Next, I delved into the history of 20th century theater posters for the Stages of Identity exhibit. Some, like this modernist image of a play showing Tel Aviv's Habima Theater, had a fair amount of scholarship written about them. Others did not. And complicated by different languages, this one, for instance, is a Russian theater troupe whose name was translated to French for their performance in Paris, and then I had to try to find English resources on it. This information was not always easy to come by. But once I was able to find a thread of information, that thread led me to interesting places. For instance, this poster from a 1990 performance announced a show by a musical theater troupe that, it turns out, originated in the Jewish autonomous region of Russia, Azerbaijan, which is located in a part of Siberia that is no longer autonomous but still has a fairly large Jewish community. And this poster from 1919 announced a performance created for Berkeley's own Greek theater, which put the university on the map, not only as a site for cultural performance, but also for cultural production. At the end of each semester, I would come out feeling as though there is one more topic in the vast array of Jewish life that I can talk about with a bit of confidence. So, when Francesco suggested last summer that I conduct research for a new exhibition centered on a painting by an artist I had never heard of, about Moses Mendelssohn, an 18th century German Jewish philosopher whose name I vaguely remembered from one of my history classes, I said, why not? The exhibition, I learned, would blow out the featured painting, Moritz D. Oppenheim's Lavater and Lessing Visit Moses Mendelssohn. Each object depicted in the painting was to be examined, and the exhibition would recreate Mendelssohn's study within the gallery space, using objects found in the Magnes collection. To my surprise, this deconstructionist theory began to make sense fairly quickly. But just when I felt I had a grasp on my new subject, Francesco began to explain the concept behind the painting itself, something I was perhaps unprepared for. Oppenheim's painting, I learned, depicts a moment, the meeting of three great Enlightenment figures, Lavater, Lessing, and Mendelssohn, that never occurred in real life. It is, in fact, a conflation of two distinct historical moments, and it is Oppenheim's nod to Lessing's 18th century text, Laocoon, which discusses the ability of painting to depict a single climactic moment rather than a drawn-out narrative, as does poetry. A attempting to make sense of the artistic theory behind the painting that I would be spending the semester researching. I tried my hand at reading Lessing's Laocoon. I think it might be an understatement to say that it was a bit dense. And truthfully, I only made it through a bit more than half of the text. But the idea behind the painting began to take shape in my head. And now that I'm enrolled in several classes in the art history department, I found that my attempt to read Laocoon has made it easier to understand the constant references made to it in art historical texts. After this sojourn into the realm of art theory, and a bit of preliminary reading on Mendelssohn and Oppenheim, I was unleashed in the Magnes archives with a directive to look for paper items that could have existed in Mendelssohn's study, namely items that were German and from the 19th century. I started by tackling the flat file storage space, which is just to the right as you exit this auditorium. The storage unit consists of cases upon cases of drawers, each filled with dozens of manila envelopes, all filled with various types of ephemera, an archival category, which can include newspaper clippings and other types of paper materials that were not meant to survive extended periods of time. I had no idea what I might find each time I opened a new folder, and that mystery turned this task into a bit of a treasure hunt. And, as it turned out, I found some pretty amazing things. First and foremost, I came across a multitude of images clipped from newspapers. Some were descriptive, like this ethnographic series of drawings featuring a Jewish peddler in the lower left-hand corner. Others seemed to capture a moment of Jewish life. Through this one, captioned "Out into the Wide World," it left me a bit unsure of whether it should feel melancholic or optimistic, especially as it, and many images like it, seem to have been created by non-Jewish artists or secular newspapers in order to illustrate both news stories and short fiction. This here is one of the images that I found most interesting. It's an architectural drawing of the old new synagogue in Prague, considered the oldest synagogue in Europe that's still in use today. When I found this in one of the many manila folders, I had just returned from a visit to Prague, where I had seen the synagogue in person. And I have to admit, I enjoyed it because of its association with the folkloric legend of the golem, the man-like creature created from clay to protect the Jews of Prague, who some say Mary Shelley's Frankenstein is based on. And they say that the golem of Prague still resides in the attic of the synagogue. So when I was there, and this isn't depicted in this drawing, but there were metal rungs going from the window of the attic down to the ground, it may have been a fire escape, or it may have been the way the golem gets out. Who knows? This next item was mixed into a drawer full of mizrachs, or prayer plaques. It consists of a series of photographs taken at a Rosh Hashanah service at an Air Force base in Guam in 1945. The photos were collaged together and mailed to one of the soldiers' relatives in the States. I was particularly excited to find it because my grandfather, the second man in the first photograph that I showed you, when he was in the Air Corps in the 1940s, he led Shabbos services and high holiday services, although I don't think they had quite as many attendees as this. But finding these photographs gave me a sense that I could understand perhaps a small chunk of my family's history. But neither of these things, which were so exciting for me, had anything to do with Germany in the 18th century. So my process of exploration continued and led me to several items that did seem at first to fit that initial criteria. Here we have an architectural drawing on the left, showing the inside of an unknown German synagogue. Like several other items I came across, this one has not yet been entered in the Magnus' online database, and there's no date or location inscribed on the drawing itself. I was intrigued by it, but because of the lack of information and the lack of any means by which to search for information, I had to cross this drawing off my list and move on. The second item, a seating chart for a synagogue in Frankfurt, presented more information than the first. It was German from the time period either during or just after when Moses Mendelssohn lived. But the Mendelssohns, who are primarily connected with Dessau, Berlin, and Leipzig, had little to do with Frankfurt. So once again, I moved on in search of something with closer ties to the Mendelssohn family. Some of the items that I came across did suggest a connection to the Mendelssohn family. When I found this portrait of Max Abraham displayed in the case up front, I had no idea who Max Abraham was, but his dates inscribed described beneath this image overlap with the dates of Felix Mendelssohn Bartholdy, Moses Mendelssohn's musical grandson, who's also featured in the exhibition. And the printer of the image I found is located in Leipzig, where Felix spent the last few years of his life. With two immediate connections to Felix Mendelssohn, I pulled the portrait aside, intent to see what I could find out about Abraham, who, it turns out, was a prominent sheet music publisher in Leipzig. My first thought was that I had discovered a previously unknown connection between this portrait, with relatively little cataloged about it, and Felix Mendelssohn Bartholdy, one of the stars of the new exhibition. My next thought was the somewhat sobering realization that a coincidence of date, location, and profession did not necessarily mean there was a connection between Max Abraham and Felix Mendelssohn. So I dug a bit more into the biographies of Abraham to find the publishing houses where he worked, and to see if any of those houses had published Mendelssohn Bartholdy's music. They had not. So with that dead end and nothing concrete linking the two figures, the portrait of Max Abraham had to return to storage. Eventually, I did stumble upon something that could potentially fit into the exhibition, and it too is in the case of Friends. In fact, this single page clipped from the Aldine, a late 19th century arts magazine in New York, contains several elements that connect it in some way to our featured Oppenheim painting. The central image, entitled The Feast of Passover, is a print of an engraving made by Moritz D. Oppenheim, an engraving of his painting. The hanging lamp in the newspaper image is distinctive as it combines both a chandelier at top, intended for everyday use, and an oil lamp at the bottom, intended for ritual use. In this detail, you can see that the lamp is nearly identical to the one Oppenheim painted into Lavater and Lessing visit Moses Mendelssohn, despite the fact that that lamp was not in common use during Mendelssohn's lifetime. On the right, you can see one of several hanging lamps from the Magnes collection that is on display in the exhibition currently. It, too, has a two-part construction. Below this image, embedded in the text, is a quotation attributed to Gotthold Ephraim Lessing. This at first seemed to be yet another connection between the newspaper clipping and our exhibition. However, the search for the provenance of the quote proved circular. The only places I could find it mentioned were in reference to this very clipping in the Aldine. In the end, we decided that the only concrete connection this clipping held to the exhibition was the image of the lamp. But with three real hanging lamps in the collection, the clipping was, unfortunately, left on the cutting room floor. And that leads me to some of the images that did make the cut and are included in the exhibition and on view in the gallery now. This engraving depicts the execution of Joseph Seuss Oppenheimer, a court Jew in Worms, who was accused of fraud and embezzlement in the early 18th century and publicly executed. When I found it in a drawer with several misrafs, as well as the Air Force poster, I almost overlooked it. And when I did decide to look into it, it was more due to a hope that Joseph Seuss Oppenheimer was related to Moritz D. Oppenheim, the painter. What I discovered, though, was infinitely better. Joseph Seuss Oppenheimer was a cousin of Mendelssohn's wife, Frau Guggenheim. Because of the immediate familial connection between Oppenheimer and the Mendelssohns, the image is included in the exhibition. And here it is on the left in its gallery space. Another image, Der Zweifler, the doubter, claims no direct connection to the Mendelssohn clan. Initially, I noticed it because I liked the subject matter, a theological debate. The titular doubter sits looking seemingly unconvinced as two gesticulating scholars converse with him over a stack of books. As I looked more at the image, it became clear that as in the Feast of Passover, the iconography of these three figures recalls Oppenheim's painting. Lavater, Lessing, and Mendelssohn are positioned as a triad at a table centered around a book as well. As the exhibition works to place objects similar to those in the painting around a gallery, in order to create a space within the work, Der Zweifler seemed a perfect substitute for the human component. And here it is in the exhibition space. I had stumbled upon Der Zweifler's visual similarity to an aspect of the painting just as I reached the last of the uncataloged ephemera folders. The next step was to search the catalog for known objects in the collection that might correspond to some element of the painting. With a list of these objects, including the chef set, the cane, and the hand-washing basin in the painting. I input various combinations of words with various combinations of spellings into the Magnes' online database. And, you know, it was a bit difficult. But one of the more difficult elements to find in the Magnes collection was the tricorn hat, sitting on the chair in the foreground of the painting. Presumably belonging to either Lavater or Lessing, it juxtaposes secular social life with the religious life, exemplified by Mendelssohn's yarmulke, which Oppenheim painted in, though there's no historical indication that Mendelssohn wore one during his lifetime. Eventually, I did find a reference for the tricornered hat in the collection, in another work by Oppenheim, A Study for an Unknown Painting. Here you can see the comparison with Oppenheim's painting. And here it is in its exhibition space. Further database searches yielded more items that could have existed within Mendelssohn's living space. Some results were fairly obvious, as with the tricornered hat. This basin, which is included in the exhibition, is the only item in the Magnes collection that looks remotely similar to the basin in Oppenheim's painting. Other searches yielded several possibilities. For instance, I found two tea sets that both looked promising. We chose to include one with a bit more history attached to it, which was a wedding gift to an Italian noble. Once the objects to be included in the exhibition were finalized, my role transitioned to more specific object research. Some of this involved trying to decipher the engraver's signatures on some of the prints that I showed you. Some of it involved trying to find the provenance of objects like this teacup. The information went into object labels, and my role in putting together the exhibition neared its end. The hands-on experience that I've had working at the Magnes has been incredible. It has not only introduced me to the museum field, but it has also encouraged me to explore it further. Now, in my final semester at Berkeley, I'm taking a curatorial seminar in the art history department, and I'm thinking about pursuing museum positions after I graduate. I don't know at this point if I want to have a career in museums. I do know that I care deeply about preserving culture and about providing a platform for it in order to engage the public outside of the academic world. And I know that wherever I go, I find a place like the Magnes, where I'm discovering something new every day.
That was just terrific. Thank you. been to many, many lectures, especially this year, and yours was so engaging and so informative. I really compliment you. And I think that someone here is very sorry to think that you're graduating. but I just wanted to mention that I've heard Barbara Hershey at Gimlet speak a couple of times around the Pauline Museum. And she touched a little bit on some of the things you talked about. They're creating a collection from no collection and, you know, looking for things and trying to recreate how they might present something so that it seems like they have a lot more than they actually do to work with, but a lot of research and, you know, layers of research that are involved. So I really didn't know, but I just think that everybody should hear your talk.
Well, I think that with your graduation, you actually leave behind a graduation present for us, which is not just your talk, but I think that what you wrote as part of your talk is sort of like a student manifesto for the Magnes. So I think you're really building a legacy for a lot of people here that work here, that research here. So it's a wonderful. I know it should be the other way around. We should be giving you a present. But in your generosity, not only you did amazing work with us all these years, but you're also leaving behind a sizable